In this Q&A video, we're going to answer the question, how do you calculate earth fault loop impedance for a circuit? Just before we explain the answer to this question, please be aware that this video is one of a series that we've made on the subject of electrical design in association with BG Electrical, part of the Luceco group. They can be viewed individually, or you can click the link in the description below to view them as part of a free online training package to help you with your CPD, and you'll receive a certificate to prove that you've completed the course. So first of all, what is earth fault loop impedance and why do we care about it? Well, let's keep in mind that we're trying to design a circuit that is safe and will protect properties and people from the dangers that come as part and parcel of an electrical circuit. The primary danger that we're concerned with is the heat that the current running through the cable can cause. In previous videos, we showed how to select a cable that wouldn't overheat and start a fire during normal use. But what about when something goes wrong? Let's say a fault occurs and the line conductor comes into contact with the circuit protective conductor via an exposed conductive part. Well, that's the earth fault part of earth fault loop impedance. So what's the loop part about? Well, this describes the path that the current caused by the earth fault will run through. It consists of the line conductor in the supply cable to the property, the meter tails, any submains, and then the line conductor of the circuit in question. Then there's the fault itself, the CPC back to the main earth terminal, the earthing conductor either to the supplier's means of earthing or the earth electrode, and then the path back to the supply transformer either through the literal earth that we walk around on or through the supply cable. Then the circuit is completed through the winding of the supply transformer that our property is ultimately connected to. So you can see that it forms a great big loop, hence earth fault loop. But what about the impedance part? Well, the simple way to understand impedance is that it's just another type of opposition to current flow. It's similar to resistance, but it takes into account the extra opposition caused by coils in AC circuits. And because the transformer feeding the property is a big old coil, it adds some opposition to the current flow in the form of inductive reactance. Impedance is the total opposition to current flow in an AC circuit. It's still measured in ohms, just like resistance, and it does largely the same thing in that it tries to stop the current from flowing. So that's why we call this value earth fault loop impedance. But why do we care about it? Well, the fault we've just described is referred to as a fault of negligible impedance. In other words, it's a fault that causes a very low opposition to current flow. Now, if someone happened to be touching that exposed conductive part when the fault occurred, they could receive an electric shock and be injured or even killed, and so we want the protective device to disconnect the circuit very quickly. Now, if the installation is a TN system, you can see that the loop we just described is largely made up of lots of different conductors, all of which will have a low opposition to current flow. This is a good thing because if a fault occurs, the low opposition to current flow will cause a high current flow, and generally speaking, the higher the current, the quicker the protective device will trip. In fact, the regs require this tripping time in the event of a fault of negligible impedance to be really low. If we look at chapter 41 of BS 7671, we can see we're dealing with protection against electric shock, and regulation 411.3.2.2 tells us that maximum disconnection time stated in table 41.1 shall be applied to final circuits with a rated current not exceeding 1, 63 amps with one or more socket outlets, and 2, 32 amps supplying only fixed connected current using equipment. So circuits up to and including 63 amp for sockets and up to and including 32 amps for fixed equipment need to disconnect in the event of a fault within the time limits from table 41.1. Our circuit supplying this 9 kilowatt Fusion Comet electric boiler from the electric heating company has a rated current of 50 amps and therefore won't need to comply with the values in this table. However, it's good to know what they are. So looking at that table, you can see that a circuit with a nominal voltage of 230 volts AC would fall under the times in this column. This is where the vast majority of final circuits will fall in the UK. And so for a TN system, you can see the circuit would need to disconnect in 0.4 seconds. And for a TT system, the time is 0.2 seconds. But our circuit doesn't fall within the limits described in regulation 411.3.2.2. So how quickly will this need to disconnect? Well, we find the answer in regulation 411.3.2.3. It reads, in a TN system, a disconnection time not exceeding 5 seconds is permitted for a distribution circuit and for a circuit not covered by regulation 411.3.2.2. We've seen that because of the current rating of our circuit at 50 amps, it's not covered by the regulation stated there that we read a moment ago. and so our circuit can disconnect within a whopping 5 seconds. It's a fairly common question as to why larger circuits and distribution circuits can take longer to disconnect. After all, this section is all about protection against electric shock, and someone getting a shock for 5 seconds is going to know about it. The answer isn't simple and is beyond the scope of this video, but it's basically a bit of a compromise between several factors, including selectivity and touch voltages. However, in the case of this circuit, it's actually not going to make any difference, as it will disconnect within 0.4 seconds anyway. Electrical design is fun, no? Anyway, we want a low earth fault loop impedance in order to cause a high current flow to operate the protective device quickly. That's the basic principle that we're trying to achieve here. So how do we do it? Well, first of all, we need to figure out what the highest earth fault loop impedance of the circuit will be, because this is the worst case scenario for this kind of fault. This will be found at the point in the circuit that has the highest length of conductors from the protective device. In our electric boiler circuit, that's really simple because there's only one load. However, if we're wiring up a lighting circuit with lots of branches off it to different fittings, the length from loads to protective device will vary. Anyway, we know that our circuit is 20 meters long, and so that's the value that we'll use. To figure out the earth fault loop impedance of our circuit, we need to use this formula. Zs is equal to Ze plus R1 plus R2. In this formula, Z means impedance, so we've got two different types of impedance in our formula. Zs is the total earth fault loop impedance and what we're trying to find. Ze is the impedance of the earth fault loop path that is external to the building, hence the E in the subscript. R1 is the resistance of the line conductor, and R2 is the resistance of the CPC. These values, when combined, will give us the total impedance of every bit of the earth fault loop path. So, we're going to find the ZS value, and we need the ZE first of all. We can find this in a couple of ways. If it's an existing installation, we could measure it with a multifunction tester. If it's a new installation and we don't have that information, or if the supply cable hasn't even been installed yet, we could ring up the DNO and ask them what the value is. Sometimes they'll give you a specific value from their records, but most of the time they'll just quote from a list of standard values which are the maximum values they're allowed to supply you with at the origin. For a TNCS system like we've got, that value is 0.35 ohms for a 100 amp supply. For a TNS, it's 0.8 ohms. There's no set value for a TT system. If you're on this arrangement, it's basically because the DNO have refused to provide you with an earth at your intake. You'll often see a value of 200 ohms banded around for TT systems, but it's a little more complex than that. More on this in a later video. Keep in mind as well that these values are generally for 100 amp cutouts. There's different values for higher ratings of incoming fuse. So if you assume that you'll be quoted the maximum value and work with those figures, your real life earth fault loop impedance will usually be lower in reality, which is better for the purposes of this calculation. Okay, so we've got a ZE of 0.35. What about the values for R1 and R2? Well, we can calculate what these values will be for our circuit using the on-site guide, specifically information in Appendix I and Table I1. In Table I1, we find the resistance values per meter of conductor for loads of different sizes. You'll notice there's a column for line conductors and protective conductors. The very top line gives us the values for a 1 millimeter conductor and has a dash in the protective conductor column. The value of resistance given here, therefore, is just for the line conductor by itself. However, if you're running a cable that combines both the line and CPC into a single cable, they're going to be pretty much the same length, and therefore you can calculate the resistances of the conductors together. That's why in our formula, R1 and R2 are in the same brackets. We can figure that out as one number. So let's do that for our cable. We're installing a 10mm twin and CPC cable, so that means the line conductor has a cross-sectional area of 10mm squared. However, table I1 gives us a number of options for the size of CPC we're combining it with, namely 4, 6 and 10mm. So which one do we use? Well, if we look at the data sheet for our 10mm cable from Doncaster Cables, we can see it's got a 4mm squared CPC, so that's the figure that we're going to use. So our value of resistance per meter of cable is 6.44, notice, milliohms per meter. So we take this number and we multiply it by the length of the circuit at 20 meters. This gives us a value of 128.8, but keep in mind this is in milliohms. To change it to ohms, we'll need to divide this by 1,000, which gives us 0.128 ohms. As most test meters will measure to two decimal places, I'm going to round it off to 0.13 ohms. So plugging this into our formula gives us 0.35 ohms for the ZE and 0.13 ohms for the R1 plus R2 value. Adding them together, we find that the total earth fault loop impedance for our circuit as designed is 0.48 ohms. So will this be enough to trip our circuit within the 5 seconds required should a fault occur? Well, there's two ways to figure this out. I'm going to show you the simple way and hold the more complicated way back until we discuss the adiabatic equation in the next video. The easy way is to look up the maximum permissible ZS values in BS7671. We find them in tables 41.2 to 41.5. Each of these tables covers a different type of protective device. As our circuit is protected by one of these BG Fortress MCBs, we'll be using table 41.3. You can see in the title of that table, it includes circuit breakers, and the individual headings within the table state these values are for devices conforming to BSEN 60898, which is the MCB that we're using. We're using a Type B 50 amp MCB, so we look at the top set of numbers and move along this row until we find the 50 amp value. Then looking below it, we see the maximum permissible ZS value of a circuit fed by one of these breakers is 0.87 ohms. Our calculated value was 0.48 ohms, and so because this is less than the maximum value of 0.87 ohms, we know that this MCB will trip within the time limits discussed earlier. A couple of points to note about this table. First of all, these numbers go in this zigzag fashion purely so that they don't run into their neighbours and cause confusion with the numbers merging together. Also, do you remember earlier we were agonising over the fact that our big hefty boiler circuit didn't need to trip in 0.4 seconds but rather 5 seconds, and that was causing us a little bit of a worry? Well, if you look at the row for the Type D MCB, you can see that it shows the two ZS values for the different times of 0.4 seconds and 5 seconds, but it only shows one value for the Type C and B. Why is this? Well, it's because when a fault of negligible impedance occurs on a circuit protected by these MCBs, the Type C and the Type B, the breakers are so responsive that they trip within 0.4 seconds anyway. In fact, they trip within 0.1 seconds, but more on this in the next video. So there we go, that's how you calculate the earth fault loop impedance of a circuit. But you may be wondering, what's that adiabatic equation that I mentioned a while ago? What's that all about? Well, to find out more about that, check out this video right here, or click the link in the description below to view it as part of our free training package to help you with your CPD, and you'll receive a certificate as well. All that remains in this video is to say thank you very much for watching.